For today's video, I've gotten my hands on the middle child in the Mercedes CLA lineup. This is the CLA 35 AMG. This is not the least expensive AMG available in the United States anymore, however, because that award now goes to the A35 AMG. The CLA and the A are very closely related, but this is supposed to be the sexier version, and the A is just about as fast, but it's a little bit more practical and a little bit smaller overall. In this video, we're going to be focusing primarily on the CLA 35, why you might want one, how it compares to the competition, and of course, how it compares to other models within the Mercedes lineup. If you want to know more details about the rest of the CLA lineup, there's a video on the CLA 250. You should check that one out. Let's talk about the basics. This guy right here will start at $46,900. That's about $2,000 more expensive than the A35 AMG. So if you want the slightly sexier styling going on in the CLA, it's going to cost you some cash. And you should know that in terms of overall performance and handling, there's not going to be a huge difference between the A35 and the CLA 35. According to Mercedes, this model will go 0 to 60 in 4.8 seconds, thanks to 302 horsepower under the hood. We'll talk about that more in a little bit. That puts this, oddly enough, not just in the middle of the CLA lineup, but oddly enough, in the middle of the C-Class lineup in a way as well, because the C300 is less expensive than this, will go 0 to 60 a little bit slower in 5.7 seconds, but the C43 is $55,950, so more than this, and it will of course go 0 to 60 faster in about 4.4 seconds, thanks to 385 horsepower under the hood. But if that wasn't confusing enough already, there is a CLA 45 AMG that's gonna cost you a little bit less than a C43, and if the CLA 45 S ever comes to America, that's gonna cost a little bit more than that C43. Classifying the CLA is a little bit tricky. At 184.9 inches long, this is actually nearly 4 inches longer than a BMW 3 Series and half an inch longer than Mercedes' own C-Class, which is supposedly in a category one size up from this. Making things even trickier, the astute among you will notice that this is on the coupe section of Mercedes-Benz homepage in America, because when we open the doors, we don't have frames around the windows, and in Mercedes speak, all that is required to call something a coupe is a slightly sexier rear end and then no frames around the windows, and bang, you have a coupe regardless of the number of doors you have. But that's not what makes categorization tricky. It's the overall size and overall interior room of the CLA. In terms of legroom, this is not really that much smaller on the inside than the C300. It is a tiny bit smaller, but not a great deal. The trunk is not far off some compact luxury sedans in America, and the price tag can swell if you're not careful. Oddly enough, Mercedes for some reason calls the Acura ILX a direct competitor to the base version of the CLA. I'm not really seeing that many people cross-shopping those models, but also oddly intriguing, they're calling this a competitor to a BMW M240i. I'm not talking about a Grand Coupe BMW, I'm talking about the rear-wheel drive two-door model. Whether you want to call this a coupe or a sedan, I will leave to your own personal judgment, but this certainly looks like the mini-me of the Mercedes-Benz CLS, which is not a bad thing to look like. We have very similar tail lamp styling right back here, and very similar bumper styling as well. I've had a lot of questions about this little bump out right down there. That is due to a combination of, honestly, stupid American bumper laws and Mercedes' interpretation of those silly American bumper laws. I think that they could get away with not having those guys right there, but according to Mercedes, they are essential for compliance with North American rules, so that's why we get them and the Europeans don't. Back when Mercedes announced that they were bringing their inexpensive line of front-wheel drive vehicles to America, a lot of Mercedes traditionalists scoffed. They said that they just wouldn't drive like a Mercedes and that they would dilute the brand. Well, I have to be honest, I don't think brand dilution is a concern, because the AMG 35 version of this guy will get up to nearly $70,000 if you check all the option boxes. And the least expensive CLA, which is already a bit more expensive than many compact luxury vehicles out there, will actually get up to about $60,000 if you get carried away. And if you're taking a look at the CLA 45, you'd better have even deeper pockets. We'll talk about the fun-to-drive part of that question when we get out on the road. Under the hood, we find a 2-liter turbocharged 4-cylinder engine in all CLA models in the US. Things start out with a 221 horsepower tune that produces 258 horsepower. The AMG 35 flavor dials the engine up to 302 horsepower and 295 pound-feet of torque with a reworked version of that same engine. If you get the CLA 45, then we get a different engine that actually has the exhaust manifold at the back towards the firewall over there. They tell us that helps improve turbo lag and a few other things. That produces 382 horsepower and 354 pound-feet of torque, or if you're in Europe, you can get the even crazier version that produces 416 horsepower and 369 pound-feet of torque from a 2-liter turbocharged engine. In terms of power per liter, that makes this one of the most powerful engines you can buy today anywhere in the world. If a Mercedes-AMG 4-liter V8 was producing this much power per liter, we'd have an 832 horsepower engine. That would be absolutely insane. It's also worth noting that if you were to compare this to something like a Volvo S60 T6, which I think is a fair comparison, that produces 316 horsepower, that is a bigger, heavier vehicle than this, and Volvo requires a turbocharger and a supercharger to get power levels that are similar to what we find in here. Sending power to the ground is a 7-speed dual-clutch automatic transmission that's not the 8-speed that we see in the GLB and, of course, in the CLA 45. So if you get the CLA 45, we get the newer transmission. If you get the CLA 35 or the CLA 250, then we get a reworked version of the 7-speed DCT that we saw in the last generation of CLA. I have to admit, I'm a little bit disappointed by that because I do like the new 8-speed DCT. You can check out our review on the GLB for my thoughts on that particular transmission, but it does come across as a little bit smoother and a little bit better baked than this particular transmission. You'll notice that up till now, I haven't made much mention of BMW's 2 Series Grand Coupe. That's because, according to Mercedes, they think that competes a little bit more with the A-Class and a little bit less with the CLA. I'm inclined to agree with Mercedes a little bit on that, because the A-Class and the 2 Series are pretty close together in terms of overall sizing. And Mercedes says that the CLA, with its more coupe-like styling, is designed to compete with something like the BMW 2 Series Coupe, not the Grand Coupe. When it comes to front seat comfort, I have to admit that I found the regular CLA 250 seats a little bit more comfortable than the sport seats that we find in this model. This particular version does not have any adjustable lumbar support that is available, I'm told, in the CLA 35, however. We have a manual tilt telescopic steering column, if I can find the little lever right there. It has a pretty large range of motion, and the passenger seat has the same range of motion as the driver's, including the 3-position memory. We'll look at the seat in a little bit more detail in just a moment, but you should know that the bolstering on the side is fairly aggressive. So if you're a little bit wider than I am, you may have troubles fitting comfortably in these seats. Now, I found that the bolstering is positioned just about perfectly for my 6-foot frame, but I did find that the area right here around the shoulder section of the seat kind of hit me a little bit strangely in the back. If you're one of the folks out there that is for some reason cross-shopping a CLA 35 AMG with something like a BMW 2 Series Coupe, the one with the 2 doors, then you should know that hopping into the back seat is obviously going to be easier thanks to the 4-door design right here. We also have a little bit more legroom and headroom than you might think. If I try and put my head all the way back there to the headrest, I do have to crane my head to one side, but overall, the seating position back here is not that bad. Again, in terms of overall legroom, this is really not far off the Mercedes-Benz C-Class, and even though we have the sexier coupe-like profile, headroom is not too far off the average compact sedan in America. If you wanted something that was a little bit more comfortable in the back seat, you might want to get the A-Class, however. As you'd expect out of a performance variant, the interior is obviously very similar to the more pedestrian version of the CLA. You can see that we do have ambient lighting integrated into that one-piece seat and headrest design right back there for the rear seats. And we have a seat design that mimics what's going on up front, which I think is a really nice touch. There's also kind of a subtle two-tone effect going on in this interior, where your eyes are not deceiving you. That is a lighter insert right there in the section of the center seat there. Moving on up to the ceiling, you can see that we do have this cover that does not block all the light from the sunroof. I do think that's a little bit sad. I really wish that was a little bit different, a little bit more opaque, so that we blocked a little bit more. But this roof is huge, and it does open. You can see that the glass slides right there on top of the CLA's roof. It opens to right about there. It doesn't go any further back. The headrests are part of this one-piece seat design. You can see that it's styled to look like a 5-point harness seat, but these are not actually compatible with the 5-point harness. Now, I did find that these hard plastic sections, and that's what you see right here, hit me in kind of a strange place in the shoulder blades. Let me know what you think about that down there if you have some experience with this interior. The leather upholstery is perforated because these seats are both heated and ventilated, and you can see that we have that pretty aggressive bolstering right there on the side of the seat and the seat bottom cushion, extending thigh cushion right there for the driver and front passenger. Again, I had no problem with these seats at my height and overall body shape, but if you're a little bit larger than I am, these might be just a little bit tricky. Moving over to the front doors, we have some stitch materials going on, a lot of soft touch plastics. There is optional wood trim available, but this particular model has the metal trim that you can see right there on the doors. Again, 3-position seat memory over there for the passenger as well. The interior design theme is pretty similar to what we see in a number of modern Mercedes models with these round air vents right here. We have some perforated sections right there. It's not true perforated, but it does look like what's going on the seat. Again, more of that metal trim and then an injection molded upper section of the dashboard. Moving over here to the center of the dash, we find the Mercedes dual screen setup. This is basically the same that we saw in the up-level 250 as well. This offers smartphone integration, but as you can see, CarPlay is only using this center section of this large screen. I do think that's a little bit sad. I've answered this question before, but no, this is not an Apple deal. This is actually a Mercedes deal. They could use the entire screen if they wanted to. We do see the entire screen being used in a number of other CarPlay vehicles out there. Three large air vents down here, the engine start-stop button, and a button to disable the auto start-stop system for the engine. We then have the dual zone climate controls right here, a storage area where you could very easily keep your larger smartphone. We have a single USB-C interface for that MBUX system right there. On this side, we have a 12-volt charging port. I do wish that those were a little bit more discreetly hidden away. We have two large cup holders here, definitely easily able to accommodate large takeout drinks. This is a big improvement that we've seen over Mercedes from just about 10 years ago or so. It's about their ability to accommodate those large American-style drinks. It's not going to bang on anything right there in the front. We have the touchpad, which is one of the ways of interacting with MBUX. It's also a touchscreen, so if you'd rather touch the screen, you can do that. If you want to use this controller pad, you can do that as well. The toggle right here changes the drive mode. We have slippery, individual, comfort, sport, and of course, sport plus. That changes the way the suspension, the transmission, etc., all interact with one another. We have a button for the 360-degree camera system and the parking assistant systems. This button takes me over to the quick access car menu where you can see that we can adjust assistance, vehicle settings, light systems, the lane keeping assistance system, etc. There's also a programmable favorites button, power and volume knob for the infotainment system over there, and some direct access buttons to other system features. This is simply a wrist rest back here. It doesn't do anything specific, but we do have a button for the manual mode on the transmission, a button to turn off the stability and traction control or put it in sport mode. And then on the other side of the armrest, we have a button that adjusts the suspension. We can choose between Sport Plus, Sport, and Comfort. Behind that, we have a bifold lid for the storage compartment. We find some additional charge USB ports right in there, and then not too much storage space. The instrument cluster is running the same software that we see in a bunch of more expensive Mercedes models. It's controlled via this BlackBerry-style finger sensor and this home button right over there. Since we're driving an AMG, we do have some specific AMG screens, and you can see that each of these sections are highly configurable, and we have some extra information displayed on the screens that we wouldn't normally find in the non-AMG versions. If you'd rather not be distracted by any of this, there's also an understated version that brings up a clock and a simple speedometer. But unfortunately, if we move back over to the infotainment screen, you'll notice that CarPlay disappears while we're in this mode as well. And if we exit the mode, then we get that interface back. But of course, we lose the understated screen. The model that we're driving clearly has a bunch of different options on it. We have one of the optional steering wheels, so my usual disclaimer applies. The base model will look a little bit different. This is a part Alcantara, part leather steering wheel. We have a flat bottom right there, some pretty aggressive sport grips overall, and flat sides, which is an attractive touch as well. We have big paddles on the back, down on the left, up over there on the right, and you can see those buttons for controlling the screens. Again, BlackBerry style little sensors right there in the middle. This one controls that multifunction instrument cluster. This one controls the infotainment screen. You'll notice that there are no dedicated track forward backward buttons here, something that I really wish Mercedes would address in future steering wheel designs. We do have very easy to use radar adaptive cruise control controls over here on the left, and then the rest of the infotainment buttons are pretty self-explanatory over here on the right. It takes a bit of getting used to, but I really appreciate the fact that Mercedes is giving us a touchscreen and that we have this controller over here on the steering wheel, because you can control everything from the steering wheel via this little touch button, including the Apple CarPlay integration. So if I want to click over here and browse a playlist or interact with Waze or hit the shuffle button, etc., I can do that from the steering wheel, or because this is a touch screen, I can just touch that right there and it's not locked out at any speeds. If for some reason you'd rather use the touchpad in the center console, you can use that as well, but I actually find that probably the least intuitive input method. Out on the road, this thing is clearly a ton of fun, and handling is incredibly good for a vehicle that has just 245 with tires on it. From a stop, you are going to notice just a hint of lag. That's a tiny touch of turbo lag, and of course, the fact that this is a dual clutch transmission. So at its heart, it's a manual transmission, and that's why the shifts feel very, very crisp. Now, the 7-speed dual-clutch transmission is not quite as smooth as Mercedes' new 8-speed DCT that we are going to be seeing in the CLA 45, and interestingly enough, we also see in the GLB and some of the other front-wheel drive platforms from Mercedes with their less powerful engines. I'm guessing that that transmission was just not ready in time for the launch of the CLA 35, so I wouldn't be surprised if the CLA 35 got the 8-speed DCT at some point in perhaps a mid-cycle refresh. Although not quite as smooth as the 8-speed DCT, this 7-speed is certainly fast shifting, and that's part of how we get 0 to 60 in 4.7 seconds. I had this vehicle back-to-back, oddly enough, with the new Honda Civic Type R, an engine that produces a little bit more power than this, but it's two-wheel drive and it has a manual transmission. And in 0 to 60 testing, even a professional manual transmission driver is going to be slower in that Civic Type R than this. This has a little bit more weight, a little bit more loss thanks to that all-wheel drive system. That's one of the reasons that I have to admit I wish Honda gave the Civic Type R a DCT. But obviously we're here to talk about a Mercedes, so let's get right back to it. In the numbers, this went 60 miles an hour back to zero in 106 feet. That's a very good stopping distance. It's definitely shorter than the CLA 250 and very good when compared against something like a Mercedes-Benz C300 as well. Now, obviously there's so many different ways you can configure the C-Class that certain versions of the C-Class are certainly going to outstop this one. But then of course there is the CLA 45 as well. The tire choice on this guy I find interesting because up front we have wider tires than we find in the front of the C43 AMG, and I think that's what helps balance out the handling in the CLA. This feels very light, very nimble, very chuckable, and all the power is very accessible because whether I'm going 40 miles an hour here and I just floor it and there's this curve coming up, we have the power, we have the grip, and we have the all-wheel drive system directing power around to get us through that corner without feeling like you're going to get out of control. And if you had an AMG product with an awful lot more power, things can get sideways a bit more quickly. I think 300 horsepower suits the CLA incredibly well. That's a feeling that I've also noted in the Audi A3 and the S3, and of course the Mercedes-Benz 2 Series, very, very direct competitors to the CLA lineup. Although again, according to Mercedes, they think the A-Class is a bit more of their direct competitor, and they want to pit this against something like the BMW 2 Series. This is a lot of fun, but it is not quite as much fun as that 2 Series. Now don't get me wrong, this is an incredible amount of fun. This is an absolute hoot and a half. The grip is incredible and the sound is great, but it's not going to get tail happy like the BMW. So when it comes to overall handling, I'm certainly going to give this an A, but that's as compared to the BMW 2 Series Grand Coupe, not the two-door model, the four-door model, and of course, the Audi A3 and S3. I generally like adaptive suspensions, and the suspension here in the CLA 35 is no different. If you live out on a rougher road and you're looking for a performance vehicle that has a very practical bent to it, this is definitely going to be an excellent option. The suspension does not turn super, super soft, obviously, even out on a rougher road like this one we're in comfort, but it is definitely livable. This is the kind of vehicle that you could live down a rougher road and still have an awful lot of fun on the weekends. And if I firm things up here to the Sport Plus setting, things definitely still get pretty firm, but not as firm as certain other AMG models. So this doesn't end up quite as hardcore, oddly enough, as something like a Mercedes-Benz E63, which definitely seems to be a little bit firmer. If you're shopping for a CLA 35, I think you really ought to spend the money and get the adaptive suspension system. It really is going to be a better balance, I think, overall for the CLA. Back out here on the paved road, I am going to give the ride score a B- because even though I do find this a good balance, obviously this is not going to be as comfortable as the CLA 250 or the A220 or the more regular versions of the competition. Those are certainly going to be softer. And due to the price tag of this, I suppose you could also compare this to something like a Volvo S60, and that is going to be a bit more comfortable in terms of ride quality as well. When it comes to cabin noise, I'm also going to give this a B- because this is louder than the CLA 250 out on the road. I think it has to do with the tires. We do have those pretty wide tires all the way around, and that got us an extra decibel in this cabin, 72.5, so the score drops down to a B-. But fuel economy has been very, very impressive. According to the EPA, we should only be getting about 25 miles per gallon average. Even though we've been driving this pretty hard, we've been averaging about 27 to 28 miles per gallon over a week of mixed driving. And if you treat this gently out on the open highway, you'll easily be getting about 30 miles per gallon. Mercedes does include a bit of a launch control. They call it the race start. In our 0 to 60 testing, we didn't really notice that much of a difference between the race start mode and traditional transmission shift mode. The 0 to 60 time dropped just barely from 4.7 seconds approximately even down to 4.69 or so. It wasn't a huge difference, but the impact in shift quality is certainly noticeable. Regular shifts are pretty quick and pretty smooth, as you could hear right there, but if I just come to a really abrupt stop right here, and we engage the race mode, which is foot on the brake, foot on the gas, we release that, we do get a stronger launch, but gosh, that's a pretty harsh shift. Other dual clutch transmissions and other Mercedes transmissions just don't have that same kind of feeling. It feels sort of like someone punched you in the back in that 1-2 shift. Obviously, if you push it harder, we are going to get a little bit of front end plow because we have more weight up front than we find in the C300 or a BMW 330i. But this is an incredibly well-sorted front-wheel drive chassis, very similar in a way to what we see in the BMW 2 Series Grand Coupe and, of course, the Audi A3 and S3. Versus the Audi, the interior definitely feels more modern in the CLA. This interior design is one of the big reasons that you might want to get this over those. And I love this steering wheel design as well. I love the flat sides, I like the flat bottom, the steering grips are in a good position, and these shift paddles have a great feel to them. Thanks to the DCT, they also have a more rapid response than we find in the BMW 2 Series. But would I get the CLA over a more traditional compact sedan that this might compete with? Something like a BMW M340i, perhaps, or a Mercedes-Benz C43 AMG? The pricing is pretty darn similar. That is a bit of a trickier question than would I get a CLA 250 over the C300 or a base BMW 3 Series. I'm not sure about that. I love the engine that we find in the C43. That is one of my favorite engines available right now on the market. And because its price tag overlaps this so much, it's a little bit hard to dismiss that as the more expensive option. Let me know what you think about that down there in the comment section below. For 2020, the CLA 250 starts at $36,650. Interestingly enough, about the same price as something along the lines of a Volvo S60 T5 front-wheel drive. That's also going to be front-wheel drive for that base price. But most of the CLAs are going to be all-wheel drive. It's standard on the CLA 35 and the CLA 45, and an awful lot of the CLA 250s you'll find on the dealer lots will have that all-wheel drive system as well. If you get carried away with options on the CLA 250, you can get that model up to nearly $60,000. The last one we tested had almost every option on it, and that puts it definitely within the price range of the CLA 35. There's a significant amount of overlap within the CLA lineup and, of course, within the Mercedes lineup. This CLA 35 started at $46,900, but if you have all of the options on it, we do not on this particular model, you can end up at around $68,000, just under $70,000 basically. The CLA 45 AMG, we don't know the entire pricing lineup yet, but we do know it's going to start at $54,800 and very clearly will top out over $70,000. So that means that CLA 45, it could be more expensive than certain C43 configurations over there on the dealer lot. And that is what makes this so difficult to define, I guess. The only real option in America that is exactly like what we see in the CLA as far as its overall positioning seems to be something along the lines of the Audi A3, which we haven't talked much about yet. And there's a good reason for that. That is that we're getting a brand new Audi A3 next year. And it seems unfair to talk about the current A3, which is, I think, outclassed by the CLA in a wide variety of different ways. In the Audi lineup, we have the A3, we have the S3, and we have the RS3. All three of those are going to be coming to the US, and that's going to be a very close corollary to the CLA 250, CLA 35, and CLA 45. We find two different performance levels currently in the Mercedes 2 Series Grand Coupe, but again, that is perhaps a little bit more of a cross shop to the A instead of the CLA. Mercedes would like to say that this is more of a direct competitor to the 2 Series Coupe, the real coupe that actually has two doors. But I'm not sure if I buy that because the 2 Series is an absolute blast to drive. It is super, super fun. It is very tail happy. If you get rear wheel drive, obviously that calms down a little bit with all wheel drive, but it's always gonna have a very different nature than this. It's gonna feel different out on the road. It's gonna feel different behind the wheel. If I were looking for fun, I would probably get that 2 Series. But if I was looking for fun with practicality, then I really do see some good reasons to get the CLA 35. For this model, it mainly has to do with the accessibility of the power. This is the kind of vehicle that you can access all the power more frequently. And with higher horsepower options, say the C43 AMG, there are definitely times where that is a little bit too much power. If you're out on your favorite winding mountain road and you're just too aggressive with the throttle, you can get places you don't really want to be in the CLA 43. But 300 horsepower in a car this size with all-wheel drive, you can have a ton of fun, and it does sound great, as long as you can really stay away from some of those more expensive options. It is easy to get carried away with on a guy like this. I have to admit that I really would get the up-level seats if they had adjustable lumbar support. These seats are not exactly my cup of tea. We'll see what the seats in the CLA 45 are like when we finally get it on the road. Bottom line, if you're looking for something that's a little bit more relaxed, the C-Class is probably going to be the right option for you. But if you're looking for something with a lot of style, definitely more stylish, I think, than the C300, and a surprising amount of fun, then going for something like this is going to be an excellent option. Let me know what you think about all that down there in the comments section below. I think that the CLA is definitely more attractive than the 2 Series. I really like the way the Audi A3 looks at the moment, but I think this is a little bit more attractive than the current generation model. Again, we're getting an all-new A3 for the 2021 model year, and those details are going to drop any moment now, and it should be on sale before the end of the 2020 calendar year. I wouldn't be surprised if Audi one-upped Mercedes and gave us more power and better performance for probably less money. That is often the value proposition for the Audi product line, and I expect that's going to continue with the A3. Sadly, my favorite A3, which is the convertible, is not going to be on sale in America anymore, we're told. It's going to be sedan only for the A3 lineup. But for more information on that, you should obviously stay tuned. I will get you an A3 review just as soon as I can get my hands on it. In the meantime, let me know what you think about the CLA, and would you choose this over a rear-wheel drive mid-level performance option out there? I think that I might just do that. Let me know down there. I'll see all of you later.